Now, forget Sherbet, forget Wawani, and even Girlfriend. Only one band in this country commands universal respect, Midnight Oil. That's right. Since 1974, the Oils have done it their way. Their passionate commitment to often unpopular causes and their driven, powerful live gigs has made them one of the world's great rock and roll bands. We're very pleased to have their founding member, co-songwriter and drummer, Rob Hurst, with us tonight. Please welcome Rob Hurst. Rob, the Oils have been together almost 20 years.
Oh, God, no.
Yes, I'm sorry to remind you. Now, most bands that have been together that long, for instance, The Who and The Beatles, end up hating each other's guts. What's different with the Oils?
Yeah, what is different? I don't know. You throw all these blokes together on long tours in a bus, you know, for 10-month tours. It's a recipe for disaster. I don't know how we stick it out.
Does it end up becoming a bit tense?
It does. But fortunately, there's always the show at the end of the night, and you can take out, well, in my case, you can take out the aggression on the traps. You know, it's a great advantage.
The traps? Is that what you call them?
Yeah, you know, traps, you know, drums. You know,
oh, I've always wanted to know drumming slang, yeah.
Drum speak. Yeah.
Actually, when you are thumping them, are you making lots of noise? Are you kind of yelling and screaming? And
yeah, I am, actually, because, I do backing vocals as well.
Yeah,
and they tried to
and sometimes
one,
lead.
They tried to put one of those little mics, you know, that Michael Jackson wears and Madonna and all those ones, you know.
You look silly in the pointy bra, Robbie.
Yeah, they tried the pointy bra, but I kept on, being similar. All the grunting and all the expelling of extraneous noises and air kept on being picked up by the mic, and so people, audiences were coming back saying, it was good, but all this grunting and swearing going on, you know.
Strange verbal percussion.
Yeah, so they put me back on this boom mic thing, and I've had this bloke for years that sort of moves it over when it's needed and it goes back, but it's the worst job in show business because he's right next to this snare drum and the cymbals are going, and his job's like, you know, it's like opening a boom arm, you know, to let cars in at the Australia Club.
So if somebody were to release just a special album of Rob Hurst unplugged, you know, just making noises
like a Linda McCartney.
What would it sound like? Would it be something?
That's exactly it. Yeah, what? Plus a few words that we can't say on a family.
So you haven't actually evolved very far, Rob. It says, ooh,
yeah. Well, you know what they say about drummers. It's,
When you're on tour, like the 10-month tour, as you say, which is very grueling, do you sort of hide Peter Garrett's razor for a bit of a laugh, or put unprocessed uranium in someone's bed? I mean, just to lighten the load.
Well, see, Bonesy, the bass player, joined about 5 years ago, and he sort of lightened everything up. You know, before that we were this. These, you know, five against the world, you know, intensely political, you know, animals going off to save Australia and all ports in between, you know.
Yeah, now you're just these frivolous pop songs.
And now with Bonesy, it's all just, I mean, Bones has come in and he's sort of been the foil, you know. When we get all too serious, he's the one that you know, sends us all up. And we do this game called Bus Hat where, you know, I don't know if you played it, where you're sitting there and you're in a cornfield in Indianapolis, and I might put, you know, Elvis Presley on your, and I'll put, you have Keith Moon. We've got to guess.
They're both dead, Rob.
Yeah, I know. It's the story of bands on the road.
That's very sad. Mark Seymour told me that once when Hunters were supporting you during one of your songs, when the dry ice was floating up, they all crawled onto the stage where no one could see them and held onto the legs of the band members of the Oils so they couldn't dance. Is that true?
That is true, actually, yeah. We got them back, actually, a little bit later.
Did you? What did you do?
I think we glued Mark Seymour to the ground. So the roadies tried to pull him off stage. Yeah. And took a couple of planks with him.
I bet he got a bad review. The lead singer had a great voice but should move more.
Yeah, I know. They had a good tour with us, actually, Hunters. That was an example of Australian camaraderie on the road.
Yeah.
Having Hunters there, because a lot of people here forget, I think, you know, there's a lot of bands out there, and even if there's animosities here between bands or the press beat it up a little bit, you know, the stuff between, when you're out there and there's all this competition, it's nice to sort of cling to people that, you know, are familiar, and
so when
you become all, you know, nationalistic and pally with people.
So when you've got a support band on tour, you actually like to take care of them, they're not just the shit kickers.
No, I mean, they're a good drinking band.
Good drinking band.
Actually, yeah.
Yes, I can imagine they are. Now, we have here some tape of the famous drum solo from Power and the Passion. I'd just like to refresh your memories with that. Oh, power and the passion. Sometimes you I've always, you know, been one of these people that, you know, reckons he can drum but simply can't. I've always wondered, how do you select what you're going to do in a drum solo? How do you write a drum solo?
Oh, you don't. I mean, that solo there was recorded in a townhouse in London in 82, and we did it all in one take.
Yeah.
And what we did was we just set up lots of things to hit around the studio. That fire hydrant that was in the clip was in it.
Yeah.
And there was a UV lamp.
Yep.
And there's some bells. And I just sort of threw myself at all this stuff at once. And Nick Launay, the producer, just said, right, okay, well, that's it.
That's it?
And we just got it in one take. You know, I don't think I'd do it twice, but...
What's the weirdest thing you've hit in the course of drumming?
I've hit a lot of things. Not very many people.
No. You've never used Peter Skull as a percussion instrument.
I hit Roy and HG last year.
Did you?
Yeah.
Did they make a good sound?
Yeah, sort of a dull thud. A bit of blood down Roy's...
Roy would be more high-pitched than HG, I would imagine. Now, I've got to ask you this question. You do television in the States, you do it in Europe, you do it in Canada, but you never do an Australian
guilty.
TV show.
Guilty.
Why not? Are we not good enough for you?
Yeah, I know. It's a horrific double standard, and I've got no answer for that whatsoever.
Yes, you do. Have a simple answer. We'll come on your show. We'd be delighted to.
Yes, well, present company accepted. But Letterman, I mean, I guess we get a bit desperate in America because you get the feeling, oh, how many, there's 280 million Americans, and how many shows, you know, of 1,000 each is that we, you know, we're going to be here till about 2020. And so you tend to think, well, let's cut a few corners and we'll even go on Jay Leno or we'll go on even Letterman.
Yeah.
You're suddenly reaching 60 million people. You know, I mean, this was the old countdown thing they tried to temp us with, and we never went on. As you know, we never bought that. But at least they don't make you play on it.
We couldn't get into the satin jumpsuit.
We couldn't get into the satin. We don't have the big, you know, I mean, we don't have Letterman sort of, you know, all behind in the flashing disco floor.
Well, Rob, I don't want to put you on the spot, but we reach 60 million people every night.
At least.
And you have a nation here that loves you. We'd love to see you on the show sometime. Thanks very much, Rob.
Thanks, Rob.